Thank you, counsel, for appearing and appreciate you accommodating a new schedule. I hope everybody is safe and healthy, and I don't know who got sick before. Yeah, okay. You look well, so
yes,
that's good.
Well.
Good morning, sir. Good morning. We have, unfortunately, Judge Collins and Judge Hawkins could not be in attendance, but they're here by video. Do we have them? I'm just looking. I think we may still be waiting to get Judge Collins transferred over, which you might want all judges on before we get going. So we'll just wait patiently for that. Looks like he's on now. So I'm glad to be joined by my colleagues, Judge Hawkins and Judge Collins, and we now have a quorum, and we will go ahead and proceed with the only case set for argument today in this session, Fejes versus FAA, case number 22-70129. And Mr. Wells, you may proceed.
Thank you, Judge Nelson. Good morning, sir. Judge Hawkins, Judge Collins, good morning to you gentlemen. Thank your honors for allowing me to appear this morning. Lance Wells of the Law Offices of Lance Christian Wells. I represent the petitioner, Mr. James Fejes, who's present with me this morning, seated behind me today, along with my paralegal. I thank you all first for rescheduling this hearing, as I had some health complications at the last hearing that was scheduled, so thank you very much. As the court's aware, we're here today challenging the FAA's revocation of Mr. Fejes' airman's certificate. It was a lifelong revocation under subsection B2 of 44710, where an administrator shall issue an order revoking an airman's certificate if they find an individual knowingly carried out an activity punishable under the laws of the United States or the states related to a controlled substance offense.
So, counsel, as you read that, thank you for reading it, although we're familiar with it, what struck out to me was the use of the word shall. Shall usually, one of your arguments is that, you know, they had discretion, they didn't need to do this, they shouldn't have done it. And yet shall usually means, no, we have to do this. What's your argument for why we shouldn't just follow the plain language
well,
here?
I think it's twofold, actually. The word shall is certainly used, but there's a knowingly mens rea element that's here as well. And the springboard into this being under 21 U.S.C. 841B1, the elements, if this would have proceeded under B1 of 44710, this would have been a case where my client would have been indicted, charged, convicted, and then they shall issue an order at which time to revoke him. Those mental elements, if it was under B1, are knowingly and intentionally. But when we look down at B2, we still have the same knowingly element. The word shall is still there, but going to the mens rea of knowingly as to Mr. Fejes in this particular matter, we have to realize, first of all, this is a case of a very unusual, the way it presents. Mr. Fejes was a licensed marijuana cultivator in the state of Alaska. He was operating with a state-issued license. He's also a private pilot, and he owned the airplane in question. Mr. Fejes, at the time that he was operating his business, was not only operating.
But okay, so you're focusing. You're saying shall is offset by knowingly.
I think it is in this particular case. Because
well, but let me ask this, because it says the individual knowingly carried out an activity. There's no question. I mean, what is in your interpretation? What does knowingly refer to? Knowingly says he knowingly carried out the activity. I don't think there's any dispute that he knowingly flew, he knowingly had marijuana in the airplane. So what is it that he didn't know that would get him out of this provision?
Because had he been charged under, let's say, B1 subsection, he would have had the right to have had...
Can you get closer to the microphone,
I'm sorry,
please?
He would have had the right to have had a jury trial to present a defense under the Constitution. And one of the things that Mr. Fejes would have raised would have been under 14 CFR 9119.
I know, but the problem is there is a separate clause, B1, that deals with convictions, and B2 describes a procedure where the administrator can make findings without there being a conviction. So I don't see how any argument related to convictions is really relevant, because that's just a different clause.
It is a different clause, but if I look at the same portion under 2A of that, the word knowingly, it still goes to his mens rea, and at the time that he was operating, there's no dispute in the facts that he transported marijuana with an airplane.
Well, and that he knowingly did it. I mean, it'd be one thing if somebody, if there was an argument that, oh, somebody, you know, stashed marijuana in there and he didn't know about it, but that's not in dispute here.
But that's not the case. He absolutely knew the marijuana was on board the plane. However, at the time that marijuana was on board the plane, Mr. Fejes believed that he was operating lawfully in the state of Alaska, that he was operating.
Well, he may well have been operating in the state of Alaska. Unfortunately, the state of Alaska doesn't give out pilot licenses.
They do not. But he also felt he was safe under the Cole memorandums as well, which were in place at the time. Those were active.
Speaking of counsel, speaking of mens rea, didn't he attempt to deceive the Marijuana Control Board about how he transported the material?
Absolutely not. In fact, I represented Mr. Fejes during the notice of violation where there was an issue about a vehicle that broke down, actually, and Mr. Fejes trying to correct the manifest to be able to fly that at that point in time. He was charged with a violation, but he wasn't subject to having his marijuana license revoked at that point in time.
Didn't he tell the Marijuana Control Board that he drove the stuff?
No. He had started driving the marijuana, actually, when he had a vehicular problem in a diesel truck. Fuel filters, I recall, had gone out on the truck, at which time he had tried and attempted to change his manifest to fly. This wasn't the first time Mr. Fejes had flown marijuana. And each and every time, under the laws of the state of Alaska, when one flies marijuana, they must present a manifest which shows how the marijuana will be transported, whether it will go by car, what the route will be, any stops or any destinations that are along the way, sir. And in this particular case, he had a breakdown and did a manifest change. And at that point in time, that's what brought this before the AMCO control board was the change.
I'm going to read from the notice of violation. The metric METRC manifest created by Flying High Investments, that's your client, on August 12, 2017 reflects Fejes drove his personal vehicle to Fairbanks from McCarthy Road in Chichinee, Alaska. The manifest does not reflect any of the transportation of marijuana to ever be by air of any of Sherry Gilbert's vehicle information. So you stick to your claim that he didn't tell state officials that he had driven?
He had made a manifest change. He had had vehicular trouble on that run. And then he had made several runs that were, as I recall, either before that as well, to down to Juneau area. But he was not subject to losing his AMCO license for a manifest correction on there. He was not. He would have been subject to a potential small fine, but he wouldn't have lost a license.
That's not the underpinning of my questioning, counsel. The question is, doesn't this go to mens rea?
Well, I believe it goes to mens rea, certainly, but Mr. Fejes at the time, because of where he is and the remoteness of his location, your honors may not be aware, McCarthy, Alaska, where he is and where this cultivation is essentially out in the middle of nowhere. It's 100 miles past a little village of Chitna. There is no communications, very little phone, and very little cellular coverage. He had a vehicular problem, and he did a manifest change on paperwork, is what he did to reflect that he was going to fly. Yes, sir.
I mean, your argument, just speaking more broadly to the policy arguments here, you're saying look, marijuana is legal in Alaska, but these... And that's fine if you could get it by car, but you can't to some of these communities. So they you can't get marijuana in there because if you fly, you're going to have your license taken away.
In fact, 82% of Alaska, based on FAA's findings, is inaccessible except by aircraft. And that's an interesting question you have posed because for the cities of Juneau, Sitka, Skagway, Petersburg, Wrangell, Nome, Ketchikan, Haynes, Craig, Kotzebue, Bethel, Kodiak, Uniktovik, Dillingham, Northway, and Douglas, all of these communities have marijuana, legal marijuana, retail stores.
But you don't need
you have
airplanes.
To, you have to fly
oh,
in.
You do on
you
all mean, of those.
You have to fly in or in a
even
couple
in
of these,
Juneau.
You can boat in, but then, of course, you run into regulations
yeah.
with Coast Guard and water.
Well, they just got to get their local, they got to get the local producers of marijuana.
Right.
Unfortunately, many of these places in Alaska, and this is what we find, marijuana flies every day. You can look on the AMCA register and see that
And that seems to be your defense. The defense here is sort of like, look, I thought that this was okay because it was legal in the state, and the federal government, you know, has said we're not going to prosecute it. But it's very clear that we've had a ton of cases on this. It's very clear that marijuana is still unlawful federally. And yes, there's a lack of prosecution of it, but these are unintended consequences that come from the dynamics that we have set up.
Right. And are these the things that maybe the Cole memos were not set out to protect people from, aside from prosecution, the collateral?
I don't see how the Cole memos help you here.
Well, because I think it helps Mr. Fejes in the fact that it goes to where his mindset was at the time.
I have no doubt that he was operating consistent with what he thought local custom was and local law was, but that's not how the FAA regulates this. Now, I suppose the FAA could make an exception for Alaska, but they haven't done that. So we seem to be stuck with the statute as written.
We have the statute as it is.
This is the statute. You have a separate argument that the regulation, we should be relying on 14 CFR 91.19. Do you want to address that?
I do. Again, Mr. Fejes, Mr. Fejes, at the time he was operating, was flying under CFR 91.19 subsection B of the FAA rules for this particular kind of action. And when you look at 14 CFR 91.19, when Mr. Fejes reads that, and he is a 91.19 pilot, dealing with carriage of narcotics, marijuana, and depressants or stimulant drugs, paragraph A states of the section doesn't apply to the carriage of narcotics, drugs, marijuana, and depressants or stimulant drugs or substances authorized by under any federal or state statute or by any federal or state agency. Mr. Fejes, at the time that he was flying his plane under 91.19, but furthermore believed he was safe based on the carriage of narcotics under subsection 91.19 of 14C.
But what that says on its face is it says that paragraph A of this section does not apply. It doesn't say that 44.710 doesn't apply. So, and the regulation has no authority to create an exception to this statute.
44.710 doesn't create an exception with 14 CFR 91.19.
Just the opposite.
Or I should say the opposite of that. Yes, it's not 14 CFR 91.19. It's not an exception to 44.710.
But then it's irrelevant.
But if
two laws prohibit something and one has an exception and the other doesn't, it's still unlawful under the other law without that has no exception.
Depending, and in this particular case, the FAA moved to revoke him under 44.710. Mr. Fejes's position has been throughout this particular case that despite the statute, despite the reading of the statute, the things that were in place at the time would have saved him from A, being prosecuted, or having his license revoked. He didn't lose his marijuana license. He ultimately sold his business and went out of the industry a year or so later. But we believe it's our position, and looking at the other cases that are out there, we've never seen a case like this. I've seen some cases that have been referenced to being very similar to Mr. Fejes's case that have been cited, but they all involve illegal activity. And when I say illegal activity, and when I look at 44.710 and the intent of these statutes, were really for stopping drug smuggling. The DC-3 analysis that lands on the dark runway in the middle of the night and they offload the marijuana or the cocaine or whatever the drugs may be, that wasn't the case. Mr. Fejes believed
I understand your argument. Do you want to save some time for rebuttal?
I would. I'd like to save 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Thank you very
much. All right.
Much.
Thank you. We'll hear from the government.
Thank you all.
Good morning, Your Honors. Daniel Aguilar for the FAA. So as Petitioner's Counsel admits today, Mr. Fejes engaged in activity that violates the Controlled Substances Act for more than a year's imprisonment, and Congress prescribed that when an airman does that, FAA shall revoke their certificate.
So can I ask a more broader question? It seems to me if this is happening as much as it is in Alaska, and it's not particularly relevant to deciding this case, but I don't see any other cases addressing this. Like, you should be revoking all licenses if this is your position. Why is the FAA not doing that?
Well, so when I can't speak to what's outside the record in this case, but I think as the colloquy with Judge Hawkins demonstrates, here you had a state proceeding, right, about whether or not there had been a violation of the local marijuana laws. And in that proceeding, petitioner as counsel admitted, yes, I put this marijuana on an aircraft, and I've done this multiple times, and I've delivered it to dispensaries for sale. And it's at that point that FAA becomes notified of the case, and essentially when it's handed to you like that on the silver platter, one of the arguments that petitioner makes in the brief is, well, FAA should have just turned a blind eye to that. But I think that sort of blinks at reality. When you have the evidence there and FAA says, well, this
meets all the... So it was the ease with which they could get it, meaning the FAA, perhaps it's a personnel issue. They don't have the manpower to go put officials and, you know, agents in each of the cities. But it sounds like you could revoke a ton of licenses in Alaska under the same theory.
Well, that does happen on when the information gets presented to FAA. And I take your Honor's point about the ability to enforce the laws given limited resources. But if you look to the Connors case, for example, that this court decided.
Which one?
The Connors case. It's Connors versus NTSB. 844 F3rd 1143, and we cite that in our brief. That's a case where an airplane had landed and there were 15 pounds of marijuana on board.
Was this in Alaska?
That was in New Mexico. Oh, okay. At the time. If you're looking for but in that case, similarly, it's
well, that's right. I mean, I guess it's not unique. What makes Alaska unique is the need to transport by air as opposed to by car. And so you would assume, I don't know about New Mexico why they were coming in by airplane there, but it seems like you'd have a much higher percentage of this activity happening in Alaska than in most of the other states.
So I have two responses for you, one legal and one policy-oriented. Legal one is that it just doesn't matter if Alaska's passed this and said it's fine under state law, federal law still prohibits it, and that's going to lead to a potential conflict. I mean, that was the scenario in Raich. And what the Supreme Court clearly said in Raich is, it's totally fine under California law, but the federal government acts constitutionally to prohibit this across the board. And then
part of the problem here, there is something to the Connor argument, practically. I don't think legally. But the federal government has sort of given almost a tacit blessing. They've said it's still illegal, but don't worry, we're not going to prosecute you. So then everybody thinks that all they need to do is comply with state law, and then you get it situations like this. There's a ton of consequences that flow out of this that are not intuitive on their face to individuals. That's above you. I mean, this is DOJ has said that about marijuana, but it warrants some clarification, I think, from the federal government that, look, don't think that you're okay in every circumstance.
And I think that policy concern does go to the statute that Congress chose to write, right? The statute's not marijuana specific. It's about controlled substances generally. It applies similarly to when somebody is shipping heroin or shipping oxycodone, potentially without a DEA registration.
Well, right, but you don't have the same issue there because those aren't legal under state law.
But states don't need to prohibit them either, right? There's no requirement for a state to have a controlled substance.
No, I understand, but there's not the same sense of, hey, I'm okay. I think anybody taking, you know, those controlled substances would assume that they're doing something wrong. And marijuana, it sounds like this is happening all the time in Alaska, and nobody's batting an eye until you know, this case. So these are policy concerns. You couldn't do anything about this even if you wanted to. So I'm just kind of more raising it because it's an interesting aspect of this.
I take your Honor's point, and that's, you know, it's a policy judgment about how we should have these schemes reticulated interacting. But as the Supreme Court noted in Raich, I think it's at page 27, you know, Congress might change this in the future, but that doesn't deprive Congress of the authority to have the laws that it's enacted now and to prohibit it similarly. And so I think that one, Raich on the constitutional front establishes that clearly this is constitutional. It's even an easier case because it's dealing with the channels and the instrumentalities of interstate commerce. And then two, just on this.
Do we have case law in the Ninth Circuit? I looked at the Ickes. Well, Ickes is from the Third Circuit. Do we have case law in the Ninth Circuit that makes clear that airplanes would be an instrumentality that, you know, regardless of where it flies, falls under the Commerce Clause?
I'm not aware of a particular case. We also cited some cases from the Sixth and Eighth Circuits after Ickes II, but I think if you just took it as, well, this is totally intrastate activity, I mean, that argument would similarly apply to railroads and trucks.
What's our best case in the Ninth Circuit for instrumentalities? Is there one on railroads? I mean, I'm not disputing the point. I'm just wondering, in the Ninth Circuit, where we look to say the instrumentalities is just covered from the get-go, regardless of where they're going.
At this moment, I don't have a Ninth Circuit citation for you. If the court would like a supplemental letter on that, I'd be happy to provide it.
Not necessarily.
Okay. But then on the statutory framework, I think we're all in agreement that this is a mandatory scheme, and that's confirmed both by the language, the shall, but also just the statutory structure. If you look at the previous section, 44709, there it says FAA may suspend, revoke, modify. It's a panoply of options available for you. Whereas here it is shall revoke. There's an exception if there's an acquittal, and that wouldn't mean very much if there were other options available for you where you could still impose a sanction regardless of an acquittal. And then subsection F of 44710 also says you can waive the revocation requirement if it will assist law enforcement activities. And that waiver would just be surplusage if there was some latent discretion here to take other action or to just ignore it entirely. And as to petitioner's reliance on the regulation 91.19, and that's talking about controlled substances also generally. It's not just marijuana, but narcotics, depressants, stimulants. And most of those in subsection B can be lawfully transported under federal law. Many narcotics and stimulants are lawfully prescribed under the Controlled Substances Act. And marijuana can be lawfully distributed pursuant to federal law, for example, for research that's been approved by the DEA.
The thing that's peculiar about this is that 91.19 specifically mentions marijuana. So whereas the underlying statute, you know, that we've been discussing, as you noted, is not specific to marijuana, this one calls it out specifically and then creates this exception. It sort of, you know, creates this illusion that, you know, if you're within B, you're okay, when in fact you're not, because there's another prohibition that's not referenced here that doesn't have an exception. That, I mean, in some sense, the regulation is a bit misleading.
Well, so what the regulation covers that the statute doesn't is simple possession. Simple possession of marijuana is not punishable by years imprisonment. That's covered by a different statute.
Well, simple possession, even under federal law, would not be... I mean, it seems like it's punishable. The federal government has, maybe I'm misunderstanding it, but I thought even possession was actually punishable under federal law. The government's just said, we're not going to put our resources there.
Yeah, let me clarify, Your Honor. Under, it's 21 USC 844A, it's a different statutory section. It says simple possession, there it's applicable to marijuana, is punishable, but not by more than a year's imprisonment. The mandatory revocation in the statute doesn't apply to it because you can't be sentenced to more than a year. And so, therefore, if someone was engaged in simple possession, simply they had marijuana on their person, it wasn't for distribution or manufacture, the statute doesn't allow for revocation, but the regulation and FAA's general rulemaking could allow somebody to revoke or modify or suspend or take other action pursuant to that authority. And so that's what the regulation's covering that the statute is not. And given this interplay, we think, you know, for all of the reasons that the agency explained below, the revocation order is correct, and this court should deny the petition.
Okay. Judge Hawkins, Judge Collins, either of you have further questions? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
You have 2 minutes for rebuttal.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Just a couple of things. You asked about Alaska, Judge Nelson, and is that the exception? And I would say no, it's not the exception. It's actually becoming common because we have to look at other states that are involved, I think, in the same thing. And I would just simply point out to the court, California with Catalina Island, Washington with its own Bashan Island, Variety Harbor, Orca Island, all of these have marijuana stores on them, but there's no way to access them. All the marijuana is flown into these stores. Hawaii, Kauai, Oahu, Maui, Hawaii, marijuana flies.
Well, it sounds like some pilots should be a little bit more cautious.
And that's the interesting dichotomy of this, is because when one goes through TSA with marijuana, in a perfect example, you're licensed in Alaska, you have a manifest to carry marijuana, you have 40 pounds in a suitcase, you walk through TSA, hand them the manifest, and they say, thank you, have a nice day. They're the actual gatekeeper. They're federal gatekeepers. They don't keep the gate. They say, thank you, and you walk down and you get on the airplane, and the last time that we were involved in this, the trooper helped an associate of mine load the marijuana into the airplane overhead. Pilots know what's on there. Commercial pilots do. Juno had a problem of TSA, and they would go tell the pilots or tell the people at the end of the gate, but that stopped. And throughout this country, every day, this marijuana flies commercially, and it flies on private planes throughout all of these places, and places, of course, that you can even access by car because it saves times and you can move more. But for these places I've named, there's no way that you can move marijuana without an airplane. You have to have it.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that's an interesting question, whether, you know, Delta and United's pilots could be, have their licenses taken away under this statute. I don't know the answer to that.
I don't want to say it's, we know, but we don't talk about it. It's a wink and a nod and a handshake. It
starts I get you. It's a bit of a murky area. I think it needs some clarification, we may provide that clarification.
I genuinely do. It's an interesting topic. It's a case of first impression with these facts. It's an ongoing industry, and we need regulations in this industry. We do. We need them in Alaska. We need help in this industry. This is one of the major ways that it can be helped, frankly, is...
Well, we're limited, in, as you know, we're limited by an Article 3 court of what we can do. We don't enforce or change policy, so we're stuck with what the books say. And but we have your argument.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Your Honors, thank you very much. It's been an absolute pleasure to appear here, and this is an absolutely beautiful courthouse. It's been an absolute pleasure to come
here.
Well,
welcome to both of you. Thank you for your arguments and helping clarify this case for us. And the court is adjourned.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you.